Now, I would like to invite our second speaker of the today's session, Dr. Ram Gopal. Dr. Ram Gopal is an academic manager in Biocon Academy. Now, I request Dr. Rekha Puria to formally introduce Dr. Ram Gopal for today's session.
Good morning, everyone. Before we start with our second session, I would like to introduce our second speaker, Dr. Ram Gopal Rao is. Dr. Ram Gopal is currently working as an academic manager in Biocon Academy. Basically, he manages Biocon KGI certificate program in biosciences and BITS, that is Biocon certificate program in applied industrial microbiology, advanced skill development training programs, providing industrial training with 100% job opportunities for life science professionals in biotechnology, biopharma, and bioservice industries. Sir manages Biocon Academy Faculty Development Program. He is a gold medalist in his master's. Dr. Ram Gopal holds a PhD degree in plant biotechnology along with his MBA and postgraduate diploma in patents law. He has put in he has put in 20+ years of his professional career in teaching, research, leadership and managerial roles in biotechnology and life science sector. Prior to joining Biocon Academy, he worked as a full-time teaching faculty for more than 12 years. He has taught biotech, BTech, MTech, all students, and he has a brief stint of CSIRO Canberra, Australia, where he worked as a visiting scientist in lipid metabolic engineering group. Completed research projects in biotechnology funded by various funding agencies, for example, DT, UGC, etc. He has published large number of papers in national and international journals. Ram Gopal has delivered more than 50 invited talks and has conducted several training and awareness workshops on diverse topics of biotechnology, biopharmaceuticals, job skills, career opportunities, etc. With this brief introduction, I cordially invite Dr. Ram Gopal to kindly deliver today's lecture on career opportunities in biotechnology industry post-COVID-19. I think a topic on which every student, at least of biotechnology, is very interested to know where will they end up after getting this MTech biotech degree. Thank you, sir, and I welcome you for the session. Thank you.
Good morning, all of you. Thanks for a nice introduction, Dr. Rekha. Thanks, Dr. Barkha, for inviting us and associating Khan Academy with Kathambada University.
Really
thank you. And I thank our Dr. Bhupendra Chaudhary and our Dean Ma'am for a nice introduction as well as setting the stage for today's webinar. And I thank my colleague Ishwaran for sparing his valuable time to enlighten the students about the COVID medicines, vaccines, as well as what is in store for the students. And maybe the next 45 minutes or so, we would not be discussing much about the science behind COVID as well as the treatments, but we'll switch to another area, which is also one of the important topic, which my dear students who are waiting as well as spending their time with us would definitely be interested to know. So in that regard, I really would like my faculty colleagues to excuse in terms of me talking more about the career opportunities from students' point of view, but not just the science of biotechnology and biosciences. And I will also request students to post the questions maybe in the chat box at the end of the session. We will spend some time on that depending on the organizers and availability of members who are attending this. So let me just share my screen. Hope everyone is able to see the screen now.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. So here we are. We want to understand basically, is there going to be more opportunities or less opportunities? Do we have challenges ahead, or how the career options are going to shape up, right, in the coming years because of the pandemic or the COVID? So I am definitely excited to share this information because although the disease has affected us, but our career as well as future is bright. And I always see the silver lining, as I want to see in this particular image where we have some clouds in the backdrop as well as a silver lining, right? So let us jump into understanding like what are the opportunities in store. And before I go to the details, if I dissect the career path options generally available to the life science students, I do not want to talk about other options that the biotech life science students choose, like going to attend competitive exams, enter into government services, or maybe choosing non-life science career path. Just concentrating on what is in store within the life sciences, I think we can categorize them broadly into these four groups. One is academia, which is even my favorite because I spent the first 15 years of my career in this, where you start as a research student and then you do some research activity and get an MPhil or a PhD, do some dissertation works, project work, and basically try to solve some of the biological, biotechnological solutions. And if you already have seen, because of your senior colleagues, teachers and other people associated within your vicinity and your surroundings all these years, you have a scope which is going to take you towards converting yourself not just into a faculty member, but maybe in the leadership roles of like a dean or a head of the department, or finally maybe a principal of a college or a vice chancellor. If you come to the government, research institutes or some not-profit organizations, you also have this life science career path where you can become an educator or a scientist and then go to the level of a director or head of institutions. The third, which mostly today I am going to talk about, is the industry, life science industry or biotech industry or biopharma industry all put together. Most of the freshers are taken in as an executive or a senior executive, depending on whether you have an undergraduate or a postgraduate course. And after spending 3 to 5 years of service and contributing to the industry, most of them get an opportunity towards getting the designations of assistant manager or a scientist and so on. And in many industries, students who have a master's or a PhD initially are recruited as scientists, but most of the positions otherwise are like executives and senior executive or associate or senior research associate and so on. But if you see up the ladder, you can actually go up to becoming a CEO of a company or a vice president or a head of a quality, R&D, manufacturing, clinical and so on. There is also another area, the road not taken mostly by people because of a lot of uncertainty in this, that is planning to start on your own. I'm talking about why entrepreneurship, which is a tough but a very, very green, I would say, path in terms of sustainability as well as giving you more satisfaction as well as contributing back to the society. But it is not easy for students to initially think of that because they want to first get into a career and make themselves stable and earn some of that they can think about giving back to the society. So most of the industry people who are managers, directors or vice presidents, after spending maybe a decade or so in industry, they venture into this area of what you call as a consulting, where they start on their own, or an advisory role, or they start a small startup with other such like-minded people. And Government of India has a lot of opportunities in this particular area, especially after DBT has come out with programs like BIRAC, TEP and so on. So this is another area where you will not only grow, but you will be able to actually turn around your academic research experience into more and more better success stories. So these are the common paths where most of the students find. Whenever I go to college, the students are asking, why should we want life science biotech industry? I was just trying to jot down some reasons, and incidentally, I could see that out of 8 to 10 points, at least 6 of them are currently applicable to the post-COVID scenario. That is, I want to benefit the mankind to develop a drug, right? So that is the feeling with which, if you want to enter into biosciences and biotechnology, that's an ideal time which currently you are able to see. I want to save lives, I want to develop cure, or I want to prevent further people getting affected. Then you are having a lot of opportunities in biotech, biomedical, and biopharma industries. You want to develop a device which we call as a medical device, which is also today a regulated material. For example, you may have an insulin pen using which you can actually take a sustained release of insulin, right? So there you are managing or treating the disease effectively. The same now you have to think for COVID. Can I develop a device using which I am able to manage maybe my cytokine storm or maybe my oxygen level? All these things are interdisciplinary areas which will grab the attention, because devices are also equally important, not just medicines and vaccines. Then you have diagnostic and analytical, which has seen the peak, I would say, in this 2020 because of COVID, where we want to detect the disease and we want to save the cost, we want to save the time in terms of detecting. All of us are aware of this rapid antigen test and now antibody screenings that are coming up for COVID. And many, many companies are innovating in terms of developing different PCR techniques and different chip-based assays, which are being now, I think there was one Goa-based company, which has been approved by ICMR in terms of a chip-based COVID test. So that saves a lot of time in comparison to PCR, which generally takes more than half day, forget the transportation and other handling the samples. Now you also have an exciting time where you can apply as well as develop IT tools or bioinformatics tools, computational biology tools in either genomics or proteomics, because you want to speed up the activities of research, you want to solve some dead ends or hindrances that are there in the research, again saving time, cost. So this is another area where post-COVID people will be expected to use. And my colleague Ishwaran introduced you to the world of machine learning and artificial intelligence and data analytics, how that are being used now either for a drug discovery or for vaccine development or for developing a diagnostic tool. Of course, we have other areas of life sciences which people should definitely not sideline, because I have been observing and reading somewhere that whether COVID will see less importance to some other biotechnology areas other than vaccines, drugs, medicines, and diagnostics. Definitely not, because we need better lifestyle, we need health, we need food, we need functional foods, lifestyle foods, and we need supplements, right? So we have to develop novel products, processes, which are going to cater to this particular demand, maybe using Indian systems of medicine or using core biotechnology subject areas. So we are going to take care of our environment by cleaning up all the pollutants that we are generating in terms of water, soil, earth, assets, the environment. So all the sustainability goals and activities would definitely continue, because we have seen what difference it can make, especially during the lockdown, when the environment became clear, when people were not moving around. So that is also an indication that if you have a sustainable plan of integrating life science biotechnology solutions to handle water, soil, and environment, that's going to be another advantage to the society, not just by providing good food and medicine, but it's also providing good shelter where you have healthy air to breathe as well as to grow quality crops or whatnot in terms of maintaining your soil ecosystem. So these are different exciting reasons I would say students have for choosing life sciences. And this is not the end of the story. Maybe you can go back and see what are such other problems that you are facing in the life science sector and how you can actually touch life or actually touch the society in terms of choosing this particular subject. Now, many students were asking me when I was talking to our own Biocon Academy students whether COVID has posed any challenges or is it actually an opportunity. And I am an optimist. I always see more and more opportunities when there are problems which are encountered, right? We already know most of the common things that I have listed in this slide in terms of courses getting postponed, academic year is at stake, they are not able to travel to different places around India or abroad because of visa, travel, and other restrictions. And a lot of universities, including the top-notch universities like Oxford and Harvard, have started online education. Of course, there is a difficulty for biotechnology and life sciences that there is a limited scope for lab or hands-on experience in terms of all these courses. So that is an opportunity Okay, we'll talk about that a little later. Students who could not complete their higher are others who have not completed their thesis so far, right? They have missed a lot of opportunities that came up in this past 7 to 8 months. But that actually end of the road, because they have a lot in store, because they have started now, or I would say they have come out of that hiring freeze which existed with most of the companies, because I deal with companies day in and day out for Bhakhan Academy placements, and many companies were skeptical in hiring, not just because they do not have projects, but because of the safety and health issues. And the economic slowdown has also led to funding concerns. But biotechnology, believe me, dear students, is going to get more and more funding. Of course, the funding may be more initially towards the COVID, but in general, the whole biotechnology is at least being recognized as one important subject area. It cannot be neglected, or it cannot be chosen by chance, but they have to choose by choice, right? So the time has come where people have recognized that, yeah, it is one of the important area which will make a difference in terms of a healthy lifestyle or curing the diseases or this kind of situation. I request students to unmute themselves. I am able to see some background noises. Sorry. And finally, what I draw your attention because of this particular scenario is, in fact, COVID has become a silver lining, at least in this aspect for the life science students, that although there is a temporary break in our activities and actions, you have actually an opportunity in terms of new problems coming out with the new projects that are being developed by government, public and private agencies, and these are going to create new jobs. And I'm not just imagining, already I have interacted with a couple of startup companies in Bangalore, where they want students who have knowledge or who are good in, like for example, immunoassays, or who can handle PCR, or who can actually combine some of the IT tools actually into the job domain. They want people now. They are actually asking us, when is your next batch? When are these students available? Can I have a microbiologist? Can I have a data scientist here? He has a bioinformatics project. All these things are maybe earlier there also, but now time has come where these new projects that are being carried out by these new as well as existing companies will help the student community to gain more and more opportunities. So the message what I want to tell confidently again is, do not panic as well as get nervous because you had a temporary gap or maybe some difficult times. But this is going to be a challenge not just in India, but even for students who want to take up opportunities in other places. It is going to happen because people have understood the importance of health. Just to draw your attention in terms of what is happening in Indian biotech sector, because I cannot talk about the whole world within this limited time. I just could get some data from the literature, from some of the websites and sources, that if I divide the whole biotech companies in terms of different areas where they are working, you would be amazed to know that almost 50% of these biotech companies are contract research as well as manufacturing companies or services and supplying companies. That is, they make media, they make kits, they make some small instruments and other supplies. And contract research, when I say, they may not have their own drug or a vaccine, but they are working for some other agencies which have given them for contract. Contract research may also include clinical research organization. Contract manufacturing is either you are manufacturing for the clinical trial samples or you are going for commercial manufacturing. You also have around 15% of Indian biotech companies which are into diagnostics and analytical services. So students, I will tell you at the end what are the skills and how you can enter into each of these sectors. 70% therefore is already what we thought will not happen because of COVID. Now it has happened. That is, if you are good in analytical skills, if you have idea in diagnostics as well as medical and biomedical innovations, or if you are specifically good in quality or manufacturing aspects, this is the time where jobs will come to you if you are able to actually match your skill sets. The second graph actually here represents what are the different sectors within the biotech where these industries are working. And again, it is an interesting statistic. majority of the companies are working in biotech R&D services, because I have seen from students' mouth also, like when I asked them, what are your plans? They say, I want to do research and development, and they want to do in industry. And it is a costly affair, because now Ishwaran told you that it will take 6 to 8 years to do drug discovery, preclinical and clinical trials. But a lot of money is there happening now, because people want new medicines for the new drug diseases that are coming up, not just in India, but other places. So medical technology, pharmaceuticals, biotechnology services and consultancy, and all the supplying materials that are required to do these bioprocessors, this engineering, or these instrumentations, is actually taking the Apple's share in this particular pie chart. So please identify what are your strengths, and also see what is happening in the basically in the market, or basically in the global scenario. Because I see many students think that when I send a CV and when I say that I am ready to work in any departments because I am a fresher, that is the end of the story. If I am there, if I want to recruit, I will not take any student if they say I am okay for any role. If you are not clear about your strengths, what is happening in my company or in the surrounding companies, and how you map your skills such that, then something is definitely missing. So I want you to go back and spend some time on what is the sector that is flourishing. In that sector, what are the skill sets, whether my academic course, my project, my training, my intern is mapping or matching with this particular area. So based on that, again, if I listen, there are plenty of opportunities in India. And some of them I have highlighted because of, space and time constraints. If you see DDD, we call it drug discovery and development, where most people are today talking about, because we want an immediate medicine or a cure, right? Pharmaceutical, biotech and therapeutic companies, vaccine companies, drug manufacturing companies, drug delivery devices and medical device companies, they are flourishing. And all these companies cannot exist in isolation. They need a lot of tools. They need a lot of services. So you have companies which are into service sector are developing tools and other support areas. So the first three columns will tell you what all is happening in this area. And if you are good in any of the skill sets where you are matching your career skill set prospects, then you definitely have scope. I cannot now tell you all the companies here in each of these, but let me tell you, Bangalore alone has more than 100 startup companies. Out of that, 2/3 of them are not just working with test tube or with the culture. They are working on biomedical, they are working on electronics, they are working on sensors, they are working on diagnostics and so on. So it's not like that everyone will only clone a gene or develop a transgenic. Biotechnology has definitely changed, and the definition itself is not what earlier we used to call. And all the other support areas now have come to picture, where even government institutions, which I have listed here, in terms of some of the important departments or divisions where you can get job opportunities. Most of the first, second, third are related to drugs and pharmaceuticals, because I'm talking about FDA, FSSAI, CDSCO, which is our Indian Drug Controller General of India's office, Pharmaceutical Pricing Authority, DST, DBT, ICR, ICMR Labs, Patent, Trademark and Design Office, and Botanical, Zoological and Wildlife Surveys, and Forensic Sciences. Most of the students do not know that they also have opportunities if they are good in molecular biology and markers and other areas to get a lot of opportunities in this particular. But of course, the number of recruitments that happen will be less in comparison to industry, because government has that limited scope as well as funding in terms of creating those positions. You have devices where e-health is again a keyword, or healthcare informatics is a keyword which has already caught attention in US and Europe. That is, people want to know something like a genetic counseling, or going and sequencing your genome to see whether you are predisposable to already any existing genetic disorder, so on. All these areas medicine, like medicine is going up, and medicine in developed countries like CRISPR-Cas based as well as what you call CAR T therapy, which is specifically a big success story in terms of personalized medicine. but it is not complete entry for Indian scenario. But already to give you an exam, Biocon has started a new company called where we are working on this cardiac therapy to bring personalized medicine to India. Of course, not to neglect as well as undermine, you have academia, which is now challenged with new projects, new propositions in terms of the situation that is demanding. That is, they cannot restrict themselves to academic research. They have to develop themselves into a research center of excellence or an incubator, or they have to see how the research projects can actually translate into reality where they can collaborate with industries or government organizations and do some tech transfer, generate IP, generate some innovations and establish an industry-sponsored or a government-sponsored center for excellences, and also continue to train so that the manpower is actually relevant and get an opportunity in industry. So these are some of the areas which students should consider. And I again use the same word, that choice is yours, but opportunities are aplenty. And just to draw your attention with this slide, that what are the jobs? What will be the designation? Will I get promotion or will I get money? Will I get job satisfaction? These are the questions again students ask. So this slide again taken and modified from one interesting website talks about so many areas in biotechnology where hiring is happening. My own students from Biocon Academy, exceeding 500 plus, which again my colleague told you, right? They are working in almost all these areas. My students are working in HR, they are working in IP, they are working in marketing and business development, they are working even in terms of product support, technical sales support. Because biotechnology is not always, again, means you work for R&D or manufacturing. Of course, they are the bread and butter, but you have so many other areas, some of them which I have highlighted here with the red and yellow arrow marks, just to compare that there are some areas where you will have job safety, you will have more career growth, where you will become better and better and get good bonus. At the same time, you will also make some money. But the yellow marked ones, I think 5 or 6 of them are, these are access people do not want to or may not have expertise. I invite you again to see if you have any such capabilities, see that you are also taking care of some of these aspects. Just to tell you one example, how is law associated with the biotech industry? If you see most of the top biotech companies, they were because of their innovation, patents, as well as a lot of infringement and litigation cases that they have to win, either with the government or with the competitors. They hire a lot of IPR, patent and other background people. That is again an opportunity. Bio IT, like many companies now want to switch over, or IT companies want to switch over to medical and biomedical research, where they want those skill sets, not just your core biotech skills or only IT skills, a combination. They are not asking you to use a freely available databases like PubMed or NCBI, but or if you are good in some specific IT tools and how you are able to apply to a biological problem, then you have a job in bio-IT. In fact, we get some inquiries where they ask whether you have a student who is able to program or who has some project where it is not just a reproducing of what is already being done, but something which is innovative. And we have a lot of job opportunities in medical affairs. Some of my students who did course in Biocon Academy, they thought that medical affairs is entirely a business of MBBS, BDS, MDS and other medical professionals. Definitely not. In biotech and pharma industries, there are clinical trial projects where they want life science students also, chemistry, pharmacy students also, to actually complete the whole clinical trial projects, as well as to generate what you call as phase 4 pharmacovigilance data from the society, the hospitals and other people working in this particular area. So a lot of opportunities in this medical affairs are going to come post this COVID scenario. The red ones are the ones which are already there, and each of these which is listed in this particular picture has its own career path, has own its own advantages and limitations. So again, I request students to go back and see what people do when I say product management, what people actually expect you to know when you say product development? What are the skill sets that are required when I say regulatory affairs? It's not a right word. Sometimes it's called regulatory affairs, but it is regulatory sciences. Most of the students whom I interview and meet, they do not know what is the role of these regulatory agencies. They think that they are something like an inspection authorities, that's all. But that is not so. There is a whole bunch of activities that a company or an organization has to do in order to get a product. Or you want to get a food product into the market, you have an agency like FSSAI. Students do not know. I'm not saying that everything should be taught in your curriculum, but it is your job to go back and see where are the opportunities notified, what are the terminologies, whether I have any skill sets matching to those industry-specific roles. That is where I am telling you there are more choices available and you have to create your ideal job. And ideal job is nothing but which matches your skills and interests, but which is actually matching the goals, values and money and market of biotechnology and pharmaceuticals. So you have to create what is an ideal job for you based on this particular triangular scenario that I am trying to present you. There is nothing called an ideal job for a fresher. Most of the students again think that I want this job, otherwise I will not work. But sometimes you have to first gain an entry into an industry and then convert your interests and skills to your ideal job. But if you think that ideal jobs will be there like a red carpet welcome to you, definitely not. You have to first prove that your skill sets are worth by way of your academic qualification or your training that you got simultaneously from other what you call support functions. Students also have this doubt. What is that an industry when a person is hired? For example, Biocon want to hire a student after an MSc. Now, what is that I'm expecting? Right? So I again thought to list out everything, but finally ended up identifying these 6 to 7 main areas which I want to spend some time on. Students are taught, I think, either in MSc, BTech, MTech, at least couple of dozens of subjects, right? And when it comes to normality, molarity, or when it comes to difference between molecular weight, equivalent weight, or how to prepare a solutions, they stumble because they think that that is not my cup of tea, there will be some technician. Believe me, you have to start from scratch. Please go back and revise once again what are the basic calculations. And if you have not heard this term, that is metrology, go back and see what is precision, accuracy, what do you mean by validation, what do you mean by measurements, especially in scientific terminologies in different life science sectors. This is one important thing people want to test you on, apart from the biotech fundamentals. Then comes specific area interest called as separation methods, which are like extractions, purifications that we do, maybe as a part of downstream processing. And quality assurance and control cannot be taught because it's an industry-specific activity. But what actually you do in an industry, when I say QC or QA, is quality assurance is getting things done. Quality control is checking that everything is going right. These two abilities you have to develop as a part of your academic course, curriculum or your project work and see that you understand what are the skills required in this. For example, when I say quality control and ask students, can you tell me how to calibrate a pH meter? Most of them fail. When I tell them what will happen if your spectrophotometer is not there, they do not know that a colorimeter can immediately be used. They do not know some of these things like simple setting up of a pH electrode or maybe how to take sample and how to actually measure whether a reaction is happening or not. Even simple biomass estimation when a microbial culture is actually grown for whatever product that you are being produced. They always connect their understanding with a syllabus or a lab curriculum. That is the minimum information I always compare as a, you buy a computer from a shop. You get some by default, some setup, right? Maybe it is loaded with Windows or iOS and it comes with ABCD something. But that is not end of the story. What we do after we get a computer, we download several things, we install several things, we buy several things so that we want the computer to work for our satisfaction. The same you have to do with your subject. Your courses will give you some default subject knowledge exposure, but that's not sufficient. You have to understand what is actually required in terms of industry skills. Cell techniques. When I say cell techniques, it is not just plant cell or animal cell or microbial cell culture, but good microscopy, enumeration, counting, or differentiation. This again, not everyone may get exposed to because of a lot of restrictions that are available, but nothing can stop you from using the digital media and learn about what are the different cells. Again, to give you an example, I asked students, do you know what are the mammalian cells used in industry? They think that mammalian cells are used only for bioassay, for testing, for example, in anti-cancer activity. Biocon, just to give an example, we use mammalian cells to produce monoclonal antibodies for cancer. I'm talking about recombinant mammalian cells culturing in a 1,000 liter, 2,000 liter, 5,000 liter bioreactor. Your animal cell culture subjects in the college may teach you the fundamentals, but again, it is you who should see how these cell techniques actually are being applied, either to make an enzyme or to make it some other commodity or a protein or a vaccine. Coming to EHSS, which may be a new term, which is nothing but environment, health, safety and security. Many industries have roles for life science professionals in this particular department, where they want people to take care of the water, the air, the surroundings, the vicinities, and also propose sustainable development models for maintaining the industries. And a lot of support functions in industry are there where they do not get actual experts or people who are interested in this particular subject area. Again, to give an example, if I'm making a vaccine, I need a lot of people from microbiology, biochemistry, biotechnology to actually make that vaccine. But I also need people who are able to take care of the environment, who are able to take care of the water and the utilities that I'm actually using for creating the vaccine, who are able to take care of the disposing of the waste, whether biomedical waste, solid waste, liquid waste, and so on, and who are able to train the people to actually use the aseptic environment by maintaining all the safety precautions. This is another area. Then comes assay, data collection and evaluation. This again comes by way of your own efforts. I have seen dissertation projects of students where they do a lot of cut paste because of the time or lack of opportunity or training. But please remember, you should develop problem solving skills, again, not associated with your curricular commitments, but on your own. That is, what do you mean by an assay, A-S-S-A-Y, is sometimes not answered by a student when I again interact with a postgraduate. They think that it is only a cup of tea of some researcher or an industry. The simple experiment of estimating maybe a protein or an antibody in your lab is also an assay. Or maybe you check for some antibiotic using a microbial system, that is also an assay. What do you mean by data collection and evaluation? You will understand more and more maybe when you go to the final year projects or when you connect with your faculty and see how they are able to actually propose and initially get the funding and then convert the data generated into a meaningful scientific data which is validated as well as accepted either by publication or by submitting a IP application. So these are some of the skills which people expect. So when I take an interview, I will spend 15 to 20 minutes time and understand whether student is good in any one or two of these areas. I cannot expect all of you to know everything. But if you don't know where your strength lies in any of these areas, it becomes difficult for an industry person also to hire you. Because I don't want a generalist. I want someone who knows what are their strengths and weaknesses. I also try to do some competency mapping in terms of what are the soft skills, what are the professional skills that are required from a graduate, postgraduate, and the subject specific, occupation specific, and sector specific skills. So this is a busy slide. I don't want to go to the details now. But the central circular areas will tell you, you should have academic competencies, personal effectiveness competencies, workplace where you are going to spend your time, and industry-wide technical competencies or sector-specific competencies. And each of that, there is no textbook, there is no government agency or a website which will actually give you a ready-made solution. What I am also exhibiting here is one of my own interpretation. I ask all of you also to do this. identify a sector, identify what are the personal competencies, soft skills, as well as the technical competencies. And if you are good in at least one or two of them, that definitely you have a job. Just to give an example before I move on, if you are good in chromatography, this is one of the challenging areas where people are not getting enough experts. When I say chromatography, I know we start with paper or thin layer chromatography in the column colleges, or maybe we do some small column chromatography. That is fine. But what industry expects you is not just to be an expert in a GCR and HPLC or other larger chromatography techniques, but to know strong fundamentals of how the chromatography is used, either for analysis or for purification. How can you develop a method or a protocol using any chromatography, maybe ion exchange, maybe gel filtration, whatnot. But you should show that you have an in-depth understanding, but maybe you did not get a chance to do all of that. So that problem, if you are able to connect your chromatography knowledge, then you will be an asset. The same is true with cell culture. There are jobs where people want animal cell culture specialists, especially in biotech and pharma industries, because we start from that cell bank preparation. But students think that it is a routine and mundane job. Definitely not. Industries have to prepare master cell banks, working cell banks, as well as research cell banks. And cell bank preparation takes a lot of their time. And there is a lot of confidentiality as well as trust, because what you give is what production people are going to use later on, whether it is a recombinant strain or a wild strain or industry-specific strain that you have developed. So these are some sector-specific skill sets which I want you to map so that you are able to understand. Before I go to the end, I have two department-specific examples of what we expect. For example, a MSc or a BTech or an MTech graduate applies for a quality department of an industry. We call as a quality role, maybe QC or QA, or sometimes quality microbiology or quality analytical departments. What they want you is at least these three terms, I would say: calibration, verification, qualification, validation. Not to go into the details, but you should have a thorough understanding of how to use an equipment, how to calibrate an instrument, how to prepare solutions and media or buffer that you're going to use, how to analyze and interpret the data. Because the machine will do a lot of things, but if you are not able to interpret the data, for example, a chromatogram is generated. How you are going to interpret that data? How you are first generating a standard set of data and then validating it? And if you are not validating, nothing is acceptable in industry. So whether it is an equipment, facility, people, packaging, process, or even cleaning, it has to undergo validation. And when I say validation, it is nothing but repeated experimentation to prove that whatever you do falls within the specification, within the range, which is acceptable as set by your own industry standards. So this part is what expected from a student who enters into a quality department. So you should be good in terms of understanding a SOP, standard operating procedure. You should be good in terms of using an instrument, prepare the sample for it, and get yourself acquainted with that industry, drug or an enzyme or a protein or a vaccine-specific testing methods, analytical methods. So this is not, again, everyone's cup of tea. There are some people who want to do several experiments and they think that they're good for R&D. Yes, maybe you will fail in several experiments before you get some good results or acceptable results. Such people may not be suitable in quality departments, because we don't want you to fail here much. We want you to estimate something, detect something, evaluate and analyze something and succeed, because we are already developing a method and asking you to do. Whereas if you want to create your own methods, modify and do trial and error, then you will definitely fit in R&D, but may not be in quality. Another example, production, which is also sometimes called as manufacturing. There are several skill sets that are required, but I have just highlighted some of them. That is, what would be your responsibility if you enter into an industry where you are in manufacturing department? You will be working in either upstream or downstream, or what is called as manufacturing science and technology. And sometimes there are other departments called film finish and packaging and labeling. These are the five common departments in the manufacturing sector. Hello. Someone is talking in the background. Maybe
Rishabh, please unmute your mic. Sorry, mute your mic, please.
Dr. Barkha, if he is probably not able to hear you, you can please exit.
You can continue, Dr. Ram Gopal. Sorry for the disturbance.
If you can see here, I have highlighted some of the specific skill sets in terms of your act, what you will do basically after you go there. Either you have to operate a fermenter, or you will be involved in clarification, purification in terms of maybe a chromatographic column or a filtration device, or you will be involved in filling and packaging aseptically a particular drug or a vaccine molecule. And you have to use several equipment, support systems. For example, in industry, what we use is called SCADA. And these controls actually has to be as per the protocol, as per the SOPs developed. So your tasks actually on a day-to-day basis will be in any one of these five departments, what we call as key activities. And how do you know that you are actually working properly? There are some performance indicators for that. That is, whenever you prepare a batch, when I say batch, it's like a set of manufacturing that you are doing. For example, there is a 100-liter bioreactor where you are producing a monoclonal antibody using a mammalian cells called as a CHO cell system, for example. Whether your batch will be approved or not, which relations in terms of productivity and quality, which quality assurance and QC teams will tell you after you complete your fermentation process. Whether you have purified it enough using the proper chromatography methods or filtration methods, centrifugation methods. All these things will actually be the key performance indicators whether you are working to the actual satisfaction of the company as well as of the regulators who are going to approve that. So what skills you need for that? You do not need any other Greek and Latin, but you need to know how to understand individual unit operations. I think most of your subjects cover the unit operations and processes in at least one or two subjects. You should be good in GMP. We call it as good manufacturing practices, which you will be trained after you go into industry. But it is again nothing new, where you have to comply or you have to adhere to a set of rules and standards, where you have to write everything, you have to record using a digital or an annual entry. And you have to report adverse events, deviations, out of specifications, out of trends, and any such change that is happening, including failures or whatever mishaps sometimes it may happen. So your performance in a production role is depending on whether the product quality was achieved by your team when you actually made a batch, whether the quality assurance department did some feedback analysis and could pass and set that batch for finally packaging and marketing. That is one. So the technical knowledge and your assessment tools, if you have some idea, then you apply for an industry and say why you want to work in production, why you want to be involved in manufacturing of upstream or downstream or whatever. You should have some keywords, some skill sets to see that, okay, yeah, I will be suitable because A, B, C, D I have, and I'm ready to learn this rest of the things. And to sum up, what people expect for a production role, they expect you to follow standard operating procedures without a single change or a deviation. Because what RD is done in manufacturing is standardized process that is developed and taken up by the process development team, and you have already scaled it up to manufacturing. They do not want any deviation. So if you are a person who has minute eye for details and who are ready to follow the same protocol and procedure repeatedly, over a period of time, without putting your own thought processes or, okay, let me try this kind of a thing, then you will be a good, suitable person for manufacturing. And let me tell you, lot of digital, what you call as automated and single-use, disposable technologies have come here. For example, in Biocon, we use disposable bags, 500-liter, 1,000-liter bags. These bags are nothing but single-use bioreactors. They are not just bags, but they are bioreactors. So that is the stage where industry is going to. And you cannot expect everything of these things to be taught or covered in your colleges. But what they use is based on the same scientific underlying principles. Instead of a stainless steel or a glass flask or a container, we are using a single-use disposable material which has more and more advantages in terms of cost as well as cleaning and sterilization. So these are the things now which I wanted to share you in terms of industry expectations. And to sum up, most of the institutions in India, where I have traveled across India in more than 100 universities and colleges, again, not to undermine or compare anyone, I thought to just summarize some of the skills in terms of what is expected and what is actually seen when we actually meet more and more graduates, postgraduates. That is, in these 8 or 9 traits, I have classified it for your information, where maybe you can spend some time later on. That is, what is expected but not easily available, I wanted to highlight here. That is, if I take an example of projects, many college research projects or dissertation projects, they do for the sake of degree, for the sake of those credit points, for the sake of satisfying the professor, the teacher, so on. I'm not again generalizing it, but what industry expects when you say, I have done a dissertation and you carry a book in your hand is, what is finally your learning? If you are able to summarize that in terms of not like a Nobel Prize winning discovery, but whether you are able to troubleshoot, whether you have some innovative ideas that you could convert, whether you are able to get some hands-on experience because you did some project. What was your contribution? Because most of the student projects I know in colleges are done in teams of 3, 4 or at least 2 and above. What happens is, I have seen worst case scenarios where a student openly says that I did the typing, printing and binding. That was my contribution. So from that level to students getting publications as well as name in the patent applications, there are quality of projects that you can see. So I want your research papers, project presentations to be of higher quality. And that cannot happen in a day. You have to sow the seeds of these things from first, second year onwards. If it is a 4-year course, at least from second year. If it is a 2-year course, from first year itself. How do you do that? Associate with research scholars, associate with faculty, spend additional quality time. Again, my colleague Ishwaran told you, please do not compare with other subject areas, because biotechnology is like a subject which will follow you if you spend enough time on it. If you want to rush and get it for the sake of a degree, then you will start hating it or you will start disliking it. So see that you end up with at least one publication. When I say publication, it need not be only a journal. It may be a good conference, but it should have some ISBN or associated proceedings where you are able to actually show the value of that presentation. And this is where the word peer-reviewed comes into picture. If any conference or your presentation or a publication is peer-reviewed, even if it is not having an impact factor, it is fine because you have made a beginning. Basically, what I am trying to tell here is, when I ask Biocon Academy student during our course to write a technical report on a topic, for example, good documentation practices, we immediately go back to Google, download some literature and do cut and paste. But please remember, there are softwares like Turnitin where people check for plagiarism, people will check for copying, and immediately I know from what websites you have copied and what is actual contribution that you have made. I'm not asking you to every day do a new invention, but you should spend some time in terms of technical writing ability, which is very much missing in most of the biotechnology students. They are not able to write whatever they have learned in terms of experiments or projects. To summarize, please do a SWOT analysis. It is a fancy term, but most of the students do not do. But once they enter into industry or academia, you will be invariably asked to do it, either by regulator or by employer or by government agency. Identify your niche area and try to fit your career based on your talent, aspirations and interests. And people think that I complete a course, I get a job, and settle for life. Please remember networking. you have to communicate continuously. You have to keep doing additional courses, certifications, conferences, or diplomas, or whatnot. Again, not to show your feathers and stars, but to enhance your competency to match demand that is there in industry. Otherwise, you will be outpaced, you will be outgrown, as well as you will become obsolete. So, be a lifelong learner and start continuously identifying the skills required to become an entrepreneur. If you are having any such support from family, friends, maybe one day you can collaborate and start a new startup company from your college, from the campus, from the government facility or an incubation center and so on. And lastly, if you do not love what you do, please don't spend your time in biotechnology. Maybe you can find a shortcut route of getting an IT placement in your final year or do a competitive exams in government and other systems and definitely identify whether you really love that. Because biotechnology will not work by chance, it will work only by chance. Thanks for your patient listening, and I advise, request all of you to spend some time to visit our website. If you have some free time, note down the numbers, contact us, write to us. We are always there to help you. Just to sum up about Biocon Academy, we are a not-for-profit organization of Biocon. So I am not here to do any marketing or business development, because we can't do anything that is associated with making profits. Biocon is doing that. Biocon is making medicines to save lives and as well as making money, because it has to sustain and run. But Biocon Academy is only here to enhance student skills, to give them an opportunity in industry, as well as to help them to find the right kind of job opportunities after they get skilled. Thanks once again to all the faculty members and the leadership at Gautam Buddha University, and thanks for all the students for your patient listening. And I am open to any questions if they are there, or if you still have that patience to spend some more time with me.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ram Gopal, sir, and meticulous information about various job prospects after post-COVID-19. And you said that every problem has new opportunities. And you meticulously described that what are the different types of prospects, avenues, and opportunities that our students can grab. And it is only you also emphasize about the various kinds of skills which is required to enter in the industry, as well as you also said that what are the industry expectations from the students that students need to learn nowadays for entering Excel or entering or Excel in the biotech industry job. So we have sir, thank you for providing the lengthy information about students, and it's really an enlightening session for our students to know about the various kinds of job opportunities and profits in this biotechnology sector, and not only restricted to the biotechnology, it also emphasizes
thank you very much, sir. I will take over. Actually, our connection is lost. I will take up, sir, a few questions from the chat box. There are many questions. One of the main concerns that I could see through, and as a faculty, I also feel the same. One student, Alicia, has asked, sir, these days, actually, labs are not going on because of COVID-19. I think she is a final year student, and she is really worried that if she is not doing labs in this session or in the previous session, it's almost a year. Especially in university system and all, the labs are closed. So, how her journey will be affected in biotech industry? What can she do to compensate for this time?
What we have lost, definitely, is not recoverable, either as a teacher or an industrialist or a faculty or a student. But what definitely we can see is, I will say, I give my own example maybe, right? For the last 7 months, I am working from home. From 14th March, I am working from home. I have not stopped conducting interviews. I have not stopped taking classes. I have not stopped arranging conferences, webinars. I have given a dozen webinars across India for different universities. I'm not here to tell that, to praise about myself. Basically, what I'm trying to say is, in students' life, I think this is again an unprecedented, unexpected scenario, which definitely was not anticipated. What you have to do is, do some online courses and reading if you want to be in touch with the subject. Like, after spending so many years, I recently learned that I do not know much about a topic called as good manufacturing practices in pharma and biotech industries. I did a course, a short-term course. That was not again to get a degree or a diploma. I want to see that I am better connected with what is the latest that is happening. So students have to have that enthusiasm to see that they continuously upgrade themselves and keep in touch with the latest happenings. And this is where now this was an opportunity for them, maybe 3 or 4 like-minded students sit together and plan a small project, which initially may be a system-based, if not a lab skill-based. Or this was a time where they could have summarized their project or internships and write a research paper. How many students write a scientific article or an awareness article? Not again for the sake of writing in their CV, but for giving awareness to the general public about, say, a functional food or about, say, what are the good immunity-boosting foods that are available. I'm just citing an example. So you have a lot of opportunity within this particular scenario. If you are only worried about completing your degree and when I will finish the project and get a certification, that is not the best road to take, because after that, again, you are back to square one. What will you do after you actually get the degree? You have to basically face the same music either from academia or industry in terms of what are your skills, what did you do? And now specifically, they have this open question, which has already been asked. What did you do in these last 7 or 8 months? Because you are free. You cannot have the excuse of saying, I did not have a lab, I could not go to university. Everything is available at the fingertip now. Like, I also tell specific answers if you want. How many students know what is happening on Coursera, what is happening on edX, what is happening on is NPTEL, what is happening on several such online platforms where you can continue to upgrade your knowledge. I think this was the best opportunity. So, yes, hope I answered that question. My answers may not be crisp or
smooth. I think it's an opportunity to skill ourselves, faculty and students also, beyond our theoretical knowledge. We could have learned several things, like several in silico tools are there, and several programs we could have learned, and several online things were going on. Next question from Amansi is there, sir. She wants to know whether to go into the corporate sector. She really needs management degree. Actually, here we have option that BTech Biotech students can opt either for the MTech Biotech or they can also opt for the MBA. So students are usually confused that if they don't want to pursue PhD in academics, they don't want to continue after MTech. So what shall they do? Whether they should opt after BTech, they should go for MTech, or they should opt for MBA. That's a general question that students.
I think a few years back, I don't want to take the names. A couple of institutions started what you call as a MBA. Am I audible?
It's a bit louder.
Okay. Yeah, can you hear me now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. It's clear.
Okay, thank you. A few years back, I had seen few institutions started MBA biotechnology. And that was not... I think there was some background noise, I'm sorry, from someone. So, to answer this question... biotechnology is where a postgraduate degree is preferred. We all know that by this time. But that doesn't mean the BTech kind of courses who are also spending 4 years of their time are not valuable. Because I myself have trained and placed hundreds of BTech and BE biotechnology students. The advantage a post-graduation brings is they spend a little more time in depth to work on a given project or do a good dissertation work, number one. Number two, if someone has a managerial skill or an ability, at least when they are in their final year students, they should be able to assess. If you ask me, would you like to work as a scientist or a senior scientist or a director in an R&D department versus if you want to work in organizing things, organizing training, manpower, placement, my strength lies in that maybe, right? So I have to see if I have those managerial abilities inherently in me. If that is the case, please go ahead and do your MBA. If you are technically good, but you do not want to work much with people, you are not a people's person, you do not want to have continuously interacting with people and do troubleshooting with the outside third parties and so on, then you should restrict your career more towards the research and development or clinical trials or quality departments. So I cannot say which is good or bad, but again, it has to be an individual perception in terms of how their personality traits match with what they're going to do in industry. To tell you what industry expects is, I will not hire an MBA graduate as a manager directly in my production department. I will promote my production, what you call as a senior executive, as an assistant manager. And maybe I will ask him to do a management degree if required. I will sponsor that as an industry. But I will hire a MBA for project management. I will hire an MBA for business development marketing lead teams. I will hire an MBA for getting more and more funding for my company, some of the roles. Now, those skills, again, will not be taught only in your MBA degree, because those are domain specific. So your MBA should come out with a good practical application oriented, either theoretical or actual industry specific project.
Yes, ultimately I think it depends upon what student need to realize their potential.
They have to do an analysis. One is, yes, realize the potential, let them analyze. Maybe take their peers' help, seniors' help, research scholars and teachers' help, but see that, yes, what is their strength. I cannot see everyone fitting into the department.
Exactly. There cannot be a fixed answer that MBA is good or the MTech Biotech is good. There cannot be a fixed answer. It depends upon own personality and skills and potential.
But, to add a point on that, if you do an MTech Biotechnology and tomorrow if you don't know how to maybe crystallize a protein or how to do a bioprocessing and how to troubleshoot a pH probe, then you are not an engineer. Because MTech, the technology, or in biotechnology, when you say it is extension of your science knowledge, where many students think that it is again repeating the same syllabus, maybe in a higher depth. But please remember, you have to be more and more engineering and technology oriented.
Concerns that many of the students have is that if they don't go for PhD and they pursue their career in industry after MTech biotechnology, how their progress would be hampered in future, like what all they may face. Like, you know, usually we say if you have a PhD degree, that's the highest degree, and then if you have PhD degree, chances of growth are much higher compared to if you are MTech. So students generally, and they have it put up in the chat box also, whether it is necessary for biotechnology, I'm emphasizing here we are for biotechnology only, that it is essential or it's mandatory that one should first finish a PhD and then proceed and then go into the industry or whatever one wants to, instead of jumping after the MTech.
Okay. Thanks for asking this question. Because 1999, when I did my master's, I also had the same question, whether to do PhD or to go for a job. Of course, I initially went for a teaching job after doing a full-time PhD. The same, I can understand the students' situation now. If you see industry, any industry, I'm not talking again about Biocon. If I have, say, 100 positions or 100 people working in industry, maximum I will have 20 to 25 of them who have PhDs. I'm telling you maximum. Maybe some of the industries will have 10. Some of them may have 15. Some of them may have 20. The reason, you cannot run an industry only with PhDs. Okay. Vice versa is also true. You cannot run an industry only by hiring MSc, MTech or BPharm, MPharm students. Industry is an activity which is done together by scientific and management and HR and finance and law and other people collectively. So if a student want to do PhD or whether want to go for a job, again has to be the decision taken by the students, number one, in terms of what are the short-term, long-term goals that he or she has. Number two, if you ask me again, in our own industry and in many industries where I have seen people who have become the head of the departments in manufacturing, R&D, clinical, they are not PhDs. It is not mandatory that your promotions will be dependent on PhD. No. Industry only values industry experience, industry skills, whether you are able to contribute or not. And I gave you another example. In Biocon itself, we have more than 10 people who have been sponsored to do a business MBA in a business school, as well as an international PhD with world's top universities, because they want to retain that employee. So tomorrow, if you are good, if you are contributing, your own industry do not want to lose you. And if you are interested to do higher education, they will sponsor. And that is the best thing that can happen to you. But please remember, every industry employee will not be sponsored for higher education, because I have to run my show. If I have 50 employees, 40 people cannot do part-time PhD, then I have to close my industry. So you have to differentiate yourself. Therefore, what are the short-term, long-term goals? But definitely PhD is not mandatory to work in a biotech or a pharma or other industries. Of course, it will be a better opportunity, but remember, as you move up the ladder in the pyramid, maybe you are thinking you are moving at the higher level, but the space available on the top region of the pyramid is small. You are going to compete with such PhDs. And it is of no use if your PhD is not translational or application oriented, because they will hire a best PhD. They will hire a postdoc, or they will hire a guy who has not only completed PhD, but actually his PhD work is matching with some industry skills. I can separately talk on this if there are research scholars, because I don't want to trouble the students in terms of more and more encouraging or discouraging things. But just to answer this briefly, I thought I should compare.
Yes. Thank you, sir. Now I would like to invite Dr. Tashwin to share his views. Sir, he's our School of Biotechnology placement cell head. Dr. Tashwin Ashraf. Dr. Tashwin, are you here?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, thank you, yeah. Dr. Rekha, Dr. Barkha. Am I audible to you all?
Yes, yeah, sir. Yes, yeah. Sir. Yes, sir. Sure, sir.
Yeah, a bit of correction. A bit of correction is that I'm not a head of placement. I am a member of placement and academy industry coordination committee of SOBT. And with me, I have my colleague, Dr. Bhashwati Banerjee, who is also online. She is also a member of that. So I am a member of placement and academy industry coordination committee. Okay. Now, Dr. Ram Gopal, I'm really happy, and it's been after a very long time that we have had such a wonderful seminar. I'm really thankful to you and thankful to Dr. Ishwaran for giving your time on this busy day. And yes, and as you said, you are from your home and so very busy. So thank you very much for giving your time, and your presentation was wonderful. I mean, you're taking snaps of so many of your slides, so which I would use for the benefit of my students. So thank you very much. We had a very good session. Now, since I am a member of Placement and Academy Industry Coordination Committee, so I would be bothering you again sometime in future. For two possible reasons. One is, like, as a student asked, what are the internship opportunities for them in Biocon? So I would send you an email on that. Maybe you could share maybe details of person or people involved in that. And second is about the placement of our students. Let me share with you, there are so many of them are sitting here, students. I'm not boasting about it, but yes, I'm so very proud of GBU students, especially biotechnology students, and who really have to go through a very rigorous training at our school. So, and I've been to so many other institutes, so many other universities, and so when I compare, so I feel happy that my students do really fare decent or fare good as compared to so many other institutes. So now my job is to ensure that we are able to assist them in job assistance, in getting a job, getting a good job. And as you said, this is a process which has to be started and analyzed by the student, because he or she has to understand his or her strength. That's what you said, SWOT analysis is so very important at this early stage of your career. So, and which I'm sure my students would be doing it, especially the final year students. Now, after listening yours and Dr. Ishwaran's lecture, I'm sure they must be more focused about their career. Thank you very much, and I do hope we would have more such sessions, as you said, maybe possibly for PhD students specifically. So thank you very much, and thank you Dr. Barkha, Dr. Rekha, and Dr. Bhupendra, Dr. Seema Devedi, our team, for arranging this and inviting me for this. Thank you very much.
With immense pleasure, I would like to invite my heartfelt vote of thanks. With immense pleasure, I would like to extend my heartfelt vote of thanks for today's webinar on biotechnology industry scenario post-COVID-19. I'm thankful to our Honorable Vice Chancellor for his constant motivation on sharing of knowledge through webinars, etc. I'm grateful to our Dean, Dr. Seema Divedi, for her constant support and encouragement in various aspects of academics and research. I'm very much thankful to our head of the department, Dr. Bhupendra Chaudhary, for his valuable advices from time to time. My sincere thanks are due to our speakers of session today. Sir, I'm really grateful to you, Professor Dr. Ram Gopal Rao S., Professor Ishwaran, for enhancing our understanding of drug discovery and development. He very nicely showed the whole path for a molecule to become a drug, how long it takes and what are the various steps that are involved in it, for sharing the information on mechanism of infection by COVID-19 and various therapeutic approaches that are being explored these days. I'm grateful to Dr. Ram Gopal Rao S. for providing insights into the opportunities in various biotechnology sectors, addressing a big concern of almost all the biotech students: what are the job opportunities after BTech or MTech or PhD in biotechnology. Thank you, sir, for making our students aware of the opportunities. And I'm sure today, take-home message that our students are taking is that there are very good job opportunities, job prospects post-COVID-19 also. And as such, in biotechnology, the only thing that they need to do is skill themselves. When they are studying, they need to skill themselves as much as possible. Biotechnology is an interdisciplinary science. Only theoretical knowledge, only knowledge of biology will not help. More you skill yourself, more you will be having the opportunity to excel in life. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for very informative lecture. I'm thankful to all my faculty colleagues, along with Dr. Krish Kumar, faculty of School of Engineering. My thanks are due to Arsh and Varnik for coordinating the whole webinar event today. Lastly but not least, I'm thankful to the audience for having patience and for being with us today. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you all once again.
So, it's a really great moment for us to have many speakers from Biocon Academy. Thank you, Dr. Ishwaran and Dr. Ram Gopal. As Dr. Rekha has already given the formal vote of thanks, So we have a very wonderful and informative session, and you both meticulously describe about the, what are the industry expectations, what are the skills required to our students, and it's really a very meaningful session for today. And sir, we are hoping that in the next coming months, we will be organizing the lecture, we will be organizing the certain sessions to our research scholars, so you can give more valuable insights to our research scholars to enhance their skills in an industry on an industry front. So I think we are done with today's session. So on behalf of School of Biotechnology, I sincerely thanks to my eminent speakers, my Dean School of Biotechnology, FIT, and all my faculty members and students to patiently listen this session entirely. So thank you. So Dr. Bhupen, we should, I think we have done with today's session. So we should leave.
Thank you all. I'll take it.
Yeah, Dr. Bhupen.
Thank you all.
Yeah, I think he is there. So I think we can call it off, and with all the thanks to the speakers.